Hi everybody, welcome to Bayreuth. So you see it's getting dark slowly, or during this webinar it will get dark in Bayreuth, and it's Christmas, a Christmas feeling around, and we are doing Chase X-Graph. So today I want to pick up some topics we discussed at the end of the last webinar, some quite specific things, and the next webinar, my plan is to present the new features of version 1.2, which will appear at the beginning of January. Okay, let's start. So, my plan is to discuss today a little bit about access and the grid, highlighting of elements, and a very special feature named groups, and some structure things, how a construction is interpreted and how to access elements in a single layer. Okay. So, access and grid. When I see constructions of on Stack Overflow or other places, I often see that people use grid. Like this. Grid equal to true. Mm-hmm. And then you have some grid, which is good for geometry. Grid is a very old feature, and you should regard it as obsolete. So don't use it anymore. There's a great site by a great page by Murray Byrne, and he discusses access and grids too. So the grid lines are always one unit spaced apart, and this is a mess if one zooms in or zooms out. So my advice is to use axis all the time, and this I want to explain now. Okay, and for axis, we have, regarding axis, we have two possibilities, namely to create an axis, or to use the default axis. And we will start with creating an axis. And so we have axis equals to false, and we create an axis with two by defining two coordinates. Usually it's the first point is the origin, and the second point is a point in which the axis points to. Let's say a vertical axis would look like this. Okay, this is a default layout of an axis, which is not very nice at the moment, and I will show you what we can do about it. The first thing is, if you have a single axis, you can you want to have this zero tick included. So the first thing is we want to style the ticks, and we want to include zero. And it looks like this, much better. And meanwhile, with version one, we can also choose the type. And the default type is linear, but you can also change it to polar. And it looks like this. Okay, but we will keep the type linear from now on. And yeah. Then, as you see, there are different types of ticks, namely the small ticks and the large ticks. In JSX-Graph, they are called minor and major ticks. And the attribute minor ticks tells us how many ticks are in between two major ticks. So if you set it to two, then there are two minor ticks between two major ticks. Okay, we can also suppress minor ticks by setting zero. Okay. then we can set how large these ticks are. If we give some positive value like 40, then this is the value, the amount of pixels, the size of the ticks in pixels. So now the major ticks are 40 pixels. And if the value is negative, then it's an infinite size. Okay. Yeah. And okay, so yeah, we can suppress the minor ticks or set also minor height, but which will be not shown at the moment. Say 10 pixel. So the next thing we want to customize are the labels of the labels, the labeling of the axis. And this is done by the attribute label. And here we can suppress labeling altogether by setting visible equal to false. Okay, but at the moment we will continue with visibility. And while the default position may be not convenient for you, maybe you want it on the left side of the axis. So you have to specify anchor X is the right hand side of the text. Okay, X right, and anchor Y. It's you see the labels are below the ticks. So you specify middle. Something doesn't work. What did I do? Middle doesn't work. And okay, let's continue. Then we have a font size. We can choose the font size. Let's say 12. Yeah, I spoiled it somehow. But let's continue, and we do some offsetting. We can do the find controller with an offset. This is an array with an x coordinate and a y coordinate in pixel. So let's say -6 and 0. Now it's okay. So, okay, this looks much nicer. Now we want to label, at the end we want to label the axis, give them a label name. Let's say name equal to y, it's okay. Then this is not shown. For this you have to include with label. With label, and give a position label. Position RT and yeah, let's test this. Sorry, now I know where the problem is. I'm still inside of the I'm still inside of the ticks attributes, ticks object. So we'll go outside and continue here. Well, now you see the Y. And we also shift the position of the line on top and put it offset -20, -10. Okay, then you have the Y here. And of course, you can set a font size there too and do it like you want. So, okay, this is an axis. And now, I said axes are a replacement for grids. And for grids, you can hide the axis, visible false. Okay. Then only the labels are visible. Let's hide them too. So, yes, but we want to show the ticks. So we set the ticks to visible. Okay, now we can hide the labels again. And so you get the horizontal ticks. Okay, so there's a lot of flexibility in creating your own axis. Now, yeah. Now, what I also see many times in Stack Overflow and Google Groups is people want to style their axis different from the default style. So the default style you see here, if you set axis equals true, and sometimes people are not satisfied with this axis, and so they turn these axes off and create their own axis. This is of course possible, but there's a different solution, namely to style the default axis. And there are two default axes, one in X and the other in Y direction. Now X and Y. And okay, and here we can set again let's start it. This is the default layout, and we can say ticks visible equal to true, label visible to false, and the axes are also visible false, and then we have ticks. And draw zero, we have to set draw zero for this, what we did before in the Y coordinate, in the Y coordinate. And and probably minor ticks equal to zero and so on. So there are, this is a complete replacement of the grid, and it does its automatic scaling. So the board doesn't become a gray spot full of grid if the grid lines would be too narrow. Yeah, okay, this is the these are the default axes. Maybe one more thing for ticks. We have, if we look at the minor ticks, I make them unnatural large for the moment, like this, the horizontal ones, and then you can style them tick endings by giving tick endings one means they stretch out into the negative and to the into the positive direction. If it's 0, 1, they stretch out only in the to the right of the axis, and vice versa, like this. Okay. So, okay, next thing I want to mention is highlighting of elements. So let's move to the next fiddle. So if the mouse or the pointer device, as pen or whatever, is above or very close to a point, then this point gets highlighted. And sometimes people don't want to have this highlighting. And another issue is the precision. How far, how close you have to be that the highlighting is turned on. This can be set with this this JSX options precision. And it can be sent. It can be set individually for mouse, for pen, and for fingers. At the moment, in this version 1.1, it's only possible to set it for the whole board, for every element. In the next version, in 1.2, it will be possible to set this precision individually for every element, or of course for backward compatibility to the whole board. So I will tell you, I will mention it next, in the next webinar. Okay, among the attributes, the typo. How can you style this this highlighting? This highlighting. Well, you can, for example, set highlight stroke width 2, 3. This is let's say 5. Then it's much thicker. Okay. And if you scroll through the documentation, there are a few highlight attributes which enable you to change the default highlighting style. For texts and for images, there's highlight CSS class, so you can supply your own CSS class for text elements and images. Now, what we discussed last time was how to turn highlighting off. And for this, you can just set, use the attribute highlight false. So without using it, this point A does highlighting, and without, it doesn't, okay? No highlighting. Yeah, okay. Then the next request was, can we combine a group of elements for highlighting? And this brought me to my limits. I don't know. I don't know. So I can give you a solution to highlight some objects from outside, but I don't know how to highlight several elements triggered by some board events. So maybe you have an idea, I don't know. So let's look at this construction. Okay, then I have prepared two buttons here, and the two buttons are have on click events, do it, and they call some function, function do it, highlight true. So what happened? Oh, somebody has drawn on my screen. Okay, sorry, I missed the chat. Yes, I will. I would first. I will put this document after the talk. I will put it on the web page. Downloads. No, documentation, of course. Documentation, and there I will put the PDF, and in the next days also the video. Logarithmic access, it's possible. I will make another an example next time. It's a good suggestion. So okay, and how can I remove this drawings? So okay. So what do we want it to? So if highlight is true, then we want to, well, let's say we want to highlight point one for the moment. And else, we want to turn highlight off of point one. No highlight. Okay, so point one is A, and I click on this highlighting, and this point is highlighted. If I de-highlight, it's turned off. Okay, it's clear that I can now include the other points too, or other elements too, whatever I want. And I want to show you why it's not so easy to do a highlighting from inside. Let's say I do this highlighting. I turn the highlighting of point A on. And as soon as the mouse moves over the board, this highlighting is turned off because the mouse is not above this point or close to this point. So yeah, this is the problem here, and I don't see an easy solution. A question is, can we avoid listing all elements here in this function? And there's a solution, namely there's the not well-known object composition. And you can look it up in the documentation. And you can say, okay, P1 is point P1, P2 is point P2. You can give an object here. P3 is P3, and P4, P4, and line is line. And then, yeah, and then we can put just call C highlight. All elements are highlighted. Okay. Um, The question in the chat is it possible to define different versions of highlighting? Line becomes gray on mouse over and red when clicking on a button. No. Well, not directly. Then you have to work with attributes and set this highlight, stroke, color, and so on, or you just set attributes. This is also possible, of course. Yeah, and then this composition is one possibility to group elements together, to treat them similarly, treat them simultaneously. There's another possibility, namely the group element. And I want to explain this now. Look at this example. We have 4 points. We have 4 points and a polygon defined through these 4 points. And as you see, well, if I turn on has inner points of this polygon, then you can drag this polygon. But if you drag a single point or a single line, then the shape of this polygon changes. And this is a feature many people don't want. So there's a workaround, namely, it's we have groups. So board create group, and we have we put these and the group only works reasonably for points. So and now if you move one point, the whole polygon is moved, or you drag one line, the shape doesn't change anymore. Okay. That means to speak very in mathematic terms, each point that the dragging of each point applies and translation to the whole polygon. And now we can add more. We can add more more effects to such a group. For example, we can say we can set a rotation center of this group. For example, centroid. Or set rotation points, for example, we can give either an array or a single point. Let's say set at a single point. Now, if I drag on beam, it's translated. But if I drag on A, it's rotated around its center. And of course, I can also add further points. But there's another. Well, and I can also, instead of centroid, I can say P2 or just a random coordinate. Now it's rotated around P2. But we keep it with centroid. And then we can set a scale center. So we can also do scaling. Let's set it to P1 and set scale points. P3 and P4. Then if I drag with P4, then the whole thing is scaled, and it's the same with P3. And B acts as a translation, and A still acts as a rotation. Okay? And I guess there are quite nice features possible here with this, with these rotations, scaling, and centers. Yeah. Okay, and next point. How is a construction interpreted? This is a quite broad question or area. So updates, whenever there's a move down or up event on a board, then an update of all elements is running behind the scenes. Okay, and all updates run in a single thread, so there are no set timeouts or some things which run asynchronously. The only exceptions are animations, which we saw last in the last webinar. Then there's a timeout or a parallel thread, so to say, with this dumping method from the last time. And for transitions, I will show it to you in a moment. And thing is which we need timeouts is to determine Chase Xgraph at one point has to determine the size of text elements so they can align correctly, and this is done in parallel, so to say, parallel to the usual update process, and it has a small delay. Okay, and then transitions was one other exception. And let's look again at this polygon. You see, when the mouse gets over the polygon, then the highlight color comes into play or is displayed. And that is attribute transition duration. And you have to provide some milliseconds, let's say 2,000 seconds. And then there's a transition, how fast this color change appears. Okay. And also the usual highlighting is done with a zero duration, but with 100 milliseconds, I guess. It's in the default options declared. Yeah. And are there some dangerous things which have to be avoided when with this asynchronous things? Yes. Namely, you have to be careful when you load libraries nowadays. Then many developers recommend to use their library asynchronously, for example, math checks. So you use this async attribute for the link tag. But if you do that and load or start a JSX construction synchronously, so you put it into the web, the HTML page directly, then it will not wait for math checks to load. So you have to take care of this. This is up to you as a developer. Yeah. Next point. Accessing elements in one layer. This was a question recently asked by one developer. And let's have a look at this example. So what happens? There are two lines. The one line with the default blue and one line with the default red stroke color. And well, it appears that the red line is above the blue line simply because it was created after the blue line. Okay. You can change this behavior by using the attribute drag to top of layer true. Okay, and now if I drag the blue one, then it will appear on top of the layer. Or it will appear on top of all the elements in this layer. Okay, and sometimes this is useful if you want to keep the last element on top. Yeah. Okay, this is what I wanted to show you today. Now I have a question for you. We are intending to add a vector field element. We had this this discussion last time. I think it's an important element. We don't have it yet. And so I opened a discussion on the GitHub issues, as GitHub issue. And please tell me, tell us how a vector field should look like, what kind of parent elements it should have, or how do you want it, which variations should we take into account, okay? And otherwise, now it's up to you. What do you have further questions? If not, then I thank you very much for listening and enjoying JSXGraph, hopefully. I wish you a Merry Christmas and a very successful and peaceful and healthy 2021. And we see, hopefully, on January 20th at 4 p.m. at the same place. I will post the Zoom link on the website. Okay, bye-bye.